And now it is time for our second round of lightning postdoc talks, and I will turn the floor over to Liz.
Thank you. And the first lightning postdoc talk of the last session in the morning is Andrew Bergdahl.
Hi, how do you do, everyone? My name is Andrew Bergdahl. I am one of the new Omidyar Fellows. I came to SFI just this past September. My background is in ecology and physics. I did my undergrad. Sorry about that. I did my undergrad and master's in physics in Canada. Then I switched gears and did a PhD in ecology with Simon Levin and Ian Cousin at Princeton University. So my PhD was focused on collective behavior. Specifically, I was exploring how groups can better sense and respond to the environment by acting as basically distributed sensory arrays. Here is just a highlight of some of that work. On the left, you see some overhead footage of one of my experiments in which a group of small social fish is trying to track and stay in dark patches within a light gradient. And on the right, we quantify their ability to do so as a function of group size in terms of the number of individuals in the group. And the take-home message here is that there is a dramatic increase in their performance as a function of group size. So now at SFI, I would like to extend this work on collective sensing and push it beyond lab and simulation work out into the field to see how real animal groups in nature can enhance their ability to navigate by being part of a group. My two broad questions are basically, what is the mechanism behind this collective enhancement during migration? And beyond a better biological understanding of the specific system, I think that the understanding this mechanism behind basically a case of distributed computation could be very insightful for human technology, such as autonomous groups of autonomous robots. The second question is, how do these group level processes scale, or how do they influence the population and even ecosystem level dynamics? So for example, some of our work shows that animals who rely on collective navigation to complete their migrations might be more prone to sudden collapse. So I'm addressing these questions in a variety of systems, including wildebeest and salmon. But today I want to quickly tell you about some work I'm doing on caribou. There's a particular herd in the Canadian Arctic that makes a very spectacular migration. They rely on seasonal sea ice to reach their breeding grounds. But this sea ice is very treacherous, and it's a big source of mortality and drowning events as they try to cross it. So we have some GPS collar data that suggests they are using social information to decide when and where to cross the ice. But that data is just too sparse to dig in on the mechanism. So ideally, we would have overhead footage like we had for the fish experiments I showed you earlier. And our plan here is we're developing these systems of UAVs, drones basically, with cameras to fly above the herds and film from above. And then we can use automated tracking software we've developed already to extract trajectories and behaviors. And from those behaviors, we'll hopefully reveal how the individual behaviors are scaling up to this effective group behavior. So before I wrap up, I cut off the video, sorry. I just want to say a quick and strong thanks to SFI for taking me on. I'm really enjoying my time here, and I'm looking forward to the next few years. And I just want to say that the Omidyar program specifically has been instrumental in allowing for the freedom and resources to explore sort of this more high-risk research. So thanks very much for the opportunity to tell you about my work, and I look forward to speaking with you in person today or whenever you you visit SFI. Thanks.
I'm sure there are questions, yes. There's a mic.
I'm sure you and Caitlin have been talking about the trade-offs between being in a large group and maybe enhanced ability to navigate and everything else that goes along with being in a large group. And it seems like with this example, you have a beautiful opportunity to think about the ecological pressures on that, because probably the ice is not as reliable as it once was for anything to walk on. Is that right? And so you could think about the selection pressures for being in a large group to navigate versus having to have a lot of heavy animals on melting ice.
Yeah, so the when we're speaking with the biologists, they seem skeptical about some of this because they're like, well, the animals shouldn't want to cross in a big group because of their weight. But it's interesting for this, most barrenland caribou are very gregarious and they tend to travel together all the time. But this herd doesn't really, except for when it's crossing the ice. So it really seems like, I mean, they do form big groups to cross, so I think that this is a plausible reason. And what you were saying about the changing sea ice is a sort of a, there are double pressures on that as, you know, due to climate change, the ice is changing its timing and it's getting much weaker. But also because of that, they're allowing shipping traffic to come in and they have icebreakers going. So that is, you know, their regulation on everything. They're allowed to break anything under a meter. And right now the caribou tend to cross on 10 centimeters of ice. So they're definitely disrupting that.
You mentioned that you were interested in autonomous robots and lessons for them, and I wondered if you had already from either from the salmon or anything else you looked at something to tell those of us interested in distributed computation about how to distribute the sensing or the acting.
All right. Well, from my PhD work on the little, they're much smaller than salmon, but little minnows basically. The algorithm there was very neat. We found that any individual fish apparently didn't sense the gradient, but what they did was they sensed the absolute value of the light and then would slow down in preferred areas or speed up in bright areas, which they didn't like. And then if you think about that, if you think like this is dark over here and this is light, and all these fish are moving up through this gradient and they are tied together by social forces, these guys are going to move more quickly than these guys, so you get a sort of emergent turning without any individual being able to, you know, calculate a gradient, which is a more expensive computation because you need to either have memory or a spatially distributed measure. So already there are a couple labs, one at Georgia Tech, who have put that into actual robots, and it's quite cool. I don't have the video right here, but they'll like scurry along the ground and you can project light down and they'll find the light or dark however you program them areas. So I mean that's one I guess very simple lesson on how you can get a distributed computation and sensing.
So we actually need to scurry on. Thank you very much, Andrew.
Thanks. All right. Okay, so thank you for being here. It's a pleasure meeting you all today. So my name is Laurent Verdufrain, and I come to you from Quebec City in Canada, where I did my PhD. So I did my PhD in a very like classical physics department, looking at big, messy, complex networks and trying to get a sense of like what's the best way to represent these networks. To give you an example of what I did during my PhD, if I just zoom in on one portion of the network. So say this is a social network. Well, we looked at it from the perspective of what matters is not so much who do you know, but which groups do you belong to? So which neighborhood do you live in? Where do you work? So here that would be like all the triangles and the closely connected groups that you see. Now, Now that I'm at SFI, I'm putting way more dynamics in these networks and trying to see how those specific structural properties like clustering like impact dynamics. So for instance, if like I'm going to use the language of disease dynamics, so if we're looking at how a disease would spread on this network, well, the conventional wisdom is that clustering will hinder the spread of the disease. The idea being that if you're the root of the infection, you're patient zero, and you infect all of your coworkers, well, the link between them are wasted, so they can't infect each other because they're already infected. What you would want from the perspective of the disease is to reach new parts, new groups of the networks, and have it be more random, less clustered. Now, that's the conventional wisdom, but obviously, like epidemics or the spread of ideas don't happen in a vacuum, so we can look at how diseases or ideas would interact. So if I put two diseases, so like let's say that my blue guys are people infected with influenza, my orange guys are people infected with pneumonia, well, my purple guys would be people who have both. And when you have both, like you're way more infectious with pneumonia because flu is making you sneeze and cough. So you have more symptoms, you're more infectious. So then on one hand, you have this factor of like clustering trapping the disease, but you also have a benefit through their interaction of keeping the diseases together in groups. So just to give you like some ideas of the results we're getting. So this is the conventional, typical like impact of clustering. So in red, you have how an epidemic would spread in a matter of days on a clustered networks. And in the black curve is on an equivalent random graph. So it spreads much faster. Now, when we couple two diseases, and this is using like realistic parameters for what we would expect for flu and pneumonia, well, you don't see what you would expect. So on one hand, you have the interaction making them spread way faster, obviously, but now the clustered graph also is more efficient at spreading the disease. So we have like reasons to believe that in clustered society like ours, clustering can help the spread of disease or ideas if they are interacting together. To give you another idea of how dramatic the change can be, this is looking at like the final epidemic size if we wait long enough as a function on the x-axis of the transmissibility of the disease. So the typical scenario is this. When you have a small increase in transmissibility, you can expect a small increase in the epidemic size. So it's a continuous monotonous raising curve. But if we couple diseases, and again, this is using like influenza and pneumonia, things change dramatically. So the first thing to notice is that it's now discontinuous. So you have this like critical point where a small difference in how infectious pneumonia is would result in an increase of 90% from no epidemics at all to a big epidemic. And again, you also see that while in the classic case, the cluster graph is less efficient at spreading diseases, well, it's now more efficient, and the threshold for when do epidemics occur is now much lower. And you can imagine that this tells us that we don't know much what's going on. If we try to get like an idea of how strong that interaction is, we don't know. And a small difference in like this parameter can make a huge, huge difference. And again, like I use the language of diseases a lot, but if we're thinking about ideas, so right now we're all being exposed to dozens and dozens of ideas, well, who's to say like how this picture would scale up if we had like 100 ideas being expressed in a room like this where people are very clustered? And there's also the fact that we don't know. Some ideas may be interacting positively, and maybe, hopefully not too many, would have like a negative interaction. So this is sort of like what I'll be looking at in the next couple of months. Maybe I'll just close on this, but I should really mention that this was work done in collaboration with Ben Althaus, who's an Omidyar fellow here. And well, I'll thank you, and I'll take questions.
We probably have time for one question. Melanie, oops.
Can you give an example of, in the realm of ideas that would combine in this positive way that pneumonia and flu combine?
I've been looking a lot at like the spread of news that you can like measure by looking at Twitter and like news website and see how much like attention news is getting. And a good example of that is, recently, like the attack in France on Charlie Hebdo, the journal. Well, I was following all the news about this attack, and then like when you see like a new news coming about the subject, like a declaration that was made by someone, it also like brings a new like epidemic spike in the older news. So it's sort of the thing that if you're exposed to new elements of a story, that also makes the older story more compelling, or less compelling if you're disproving something. But that's the type of ideas that I'm talking about.
Well, thank you very much.
Thanks.
And next up is Krista Brelsford. Welcome. Uh-oh.
My name is Krista Brelsford. I'm a postdoctoral fellow here at the Santa Fe Institute. My primary intellectual goal for all of my research career has always been figuring out how to do good science that solves the problems that people in the real world face. And lack of access to infrastructure is a problem that millions of people face worldwide. So my undergraduate degree was at Columbia University in New York City, studying literally the nuts and bolts of infrastructure design. But over the course of that degree, I realized that the problems that people face about lack of access to infrastructure aren't really a problem of the quality of the designed infrastructure. It's more about the social and economic conditions under which infrastructure is built or not built. So in graduate school, I took an institutional and historical perspective looking at the water system in Las Vegas, Nevada. My dissertation was a misquote of Mark Twain: whiskey is for drinking, water is for fighting over. And what I was doing was I was looking at why we get the infrastructure that we do, and then I spent a long time quantifying the effects of particular infrastructure changes on the water efficiency of the infrastructure that existed in Las Vegas between the mid-90s and the mid-2000s. But again, I think that just this institutional and social perspective still isn't sufficient to solve the big kinds of problems that people around the world face in terms of access to infrastructure. And so here at the Institute, I'm taking yet another step towards the more theoretical to think about, is there an ideal city form? And I think that with this perspective, we'll have more ability to start to understand how these systems change. So here at the Institute, I'm working with Luis Betancourt, studying the shapes of cities. As cities proliferate and grow, this is a really central question, and it affects urban sustainable development and economic opportunity for billions of people worldwide. And analyzing urban geometries and providing taxonomies of spatial plans is something that's been done for a long time. But the central question of how best to plan a city, we think, still has remained unresolved. And that has huge consequences for people who live in places like Dharavi, which is home to uncounted hundreds of thousands and is right in the middle of Mumbai, and it's surrounded by a lot of wealth. And obviously, the people who live there are not particularly wealthy. So we think that we can show that the answer to this question is not geometric in the sense of the shape of the blocks and the angles at which the roads come into intersections, but it's topological in the sense of the connectivity of different places and different places. So we show that cities can be decomposed into two different kinds of network spaces: the access system, which here is in white, and places, which are in black here. And then we show that these spaces display universal topological characteristics that are common to all cities. So networks of urban infrastructure develop a universal topology because they surround and connect places of work and residence, which solves the central problem of cities: the circulation of people, goods, and information. Now, if we delve into the individual places, any city block anywhere in the world can be characterized mathematically by a spatial graph, and then that graph can be classified topologically based on a hierarchy of something that topologists call weak graph duals. Essentially, with the lattice in the sample block in panel A, there's a spatial graph, and then you put a node in the middle of each place. That's in purple there. It's labeled S1 if you can see that. And you do that again, it becomes S2, S3. If there's a block where all parcels have access, that S2 graph in blue is a tree in the sense that there are no loops. That's the case for the block I've shown you from New York City and from Prague. Those graphs in blue, you can't make any circles in them. There's only trees. But in A and D, there are parcels, they're highlighted in red, that don't have road access. So the S2 graph, again in blue for both graphs, has loops. So there's a fundamental topological difference between places where everybody has access and places where some people don't. So with this kind of topological perspective, we can characterize the topology of a city all the way from the access space, the city as a whole, all the way down to individual parcels, down to parcel-to-parcel relationships. And one of the interesting consequences of that is that we can show that any part of any city can be continuously deformed into any other part of any city. So we can transform bits of Baghdad into Beijing, or Paris into New York City, or, as in this block, Las Vegas into New York City, and New York City into Prague, and back again, which we think is just a really, it's a pretty and it's an interesting mathematical result. And that's one of the fun outcomes of this research. But there's also another consequence of taking a topological perspective to looking at cities that has really important practical implications. So I mentioned a bit before about the problem of access. This is a block in Harare, Zimbabwe. So when places don't have access, we can use this topological language to express the central difficulty of developing cities and neighborhoods as a rigorous mathematical problem, and when we can define it as a mathematical problem, we can solve it through the introduction of infrastructure networks into urban blocks in a minimally disruptive way that's respectful of the existing social and economic conditions in this environment. So this kind of optimization problem is fairly easy to solve on simple blocks like this one. Any of you could have done this by hand, but it's much harder to solve on large and complex blocks like this one. This is a neighborhood called Khayelitsha in Cape Town, South Africa, with 550 parcels, only 150 of which have road access. So there's a quick glance at the solution. Thank you.
Again, time for one quick question.
Curious the distinction between natural and unnatural boundaries. New York City guarded by waterways, Vegas, expansive desert.
Thank you for your question. One of the things that we haven't really brought a big distinction between boundaries that exist because of physical conditions and boundaries that exist because of social conditions. Because in either case, it's a boundary respected by the people who live there and the infrastructure that's been built there. So we don't think it has a huge impact on the topological constructs that exist within a city.
Okay, let's thank Krista. And last but not least, Marcus Schlepfer.
You're so. My name is Marcus Schlepfer. I'm here in a postdoctoral fellow since last summer. And before coming here, I've done a postdoc at MIT in the field of urban studies. And before coming to the US, I did my PhD in Zurich, at ETH Zurich, in mechanical engineering. So as you might guess from this first slide, my research interest is also very much focused on cities, and I'm very much interested in the dynamics of cities and the dynamics of people flows and how we can better predict and model the complex organization of cities. Now, the main driver, the main motivation of my research is basically that cities are growing, and through this growth, cities are becoming ever more complex. So, like most of you are probably familiar with these numbers, so cities are growing, especially in Asia and in the developing world, and already today, more than 50% of the people are living in cities. And as this trend is basically expected to continue in the near future, we urgently need new approaches and new tools to better understand cities so that we can develop better urban planning policies, and also develop more sustainable urban infrastructure networks. So, but cities do not only grow, they are also changing their internal organization. And this change is quite dramatic. So here in this slide, it's on the left side, we have like a schematic of a medieval city, which is a very simple form, basically, with very clear center surrounded by a wall. And during the last century, or during the last centuries, basically this very simple form dissolved into a much more complex urban form where we have many hubs or activity hubs that are sprinkled over the entire urban areas. And this leads to hard to predict people flows, of course. So we are faced with this increasing complexity, but we are lucky enough at the same time we see a growing availability of data, of new data that are unprecedented in terms of the number of people they cover and also in terms of the spatial and temporal resolution. And one example of such, or a prime example even maybe of such a new kind of data is like mobile phone records, which are automatically collected through mobile phone networks. And my research focus so far, also here at SFI, is to use basically or to harness this kind of data to better understand cities and to use it for a better development of infrastructure network. And I just want to give you two examples. The first example is that we use this data to measure and observe the dynamics of cities in terms of how many people are attracted to different locations. And this picture here just shows the greater Boston area. And the brighter a pixel, the more people are attracted to a given location. And now we can use this data to find a systematic relation between the distance people travel and how many people are attracted to a given location depending on the distance they are traveling and how frequently they are visiting a given location. And such observations then open basically the door for developing new mathematical models that allow us to predict the complex dynamics of cities, and this is what we are currently doing here at SFI. And besides developing such predictive models, we are also harnessing this new type of information of where people are to develop more sustainable infrastructure. And one example was just a recent project we did for Senegal. Senegal is quite interesting because almost everybody carries a cell phone, and we have cell phone data basically sprinkled over the entire country, but even less than 30% of the people have access to electricity. So knowing where people are and at what time people are active at which location helps a lot in estimating local energy demands, and using these estimations, we then helped us then to basically work out different electrification options for the country. This is shown on the right side. So basically for each location, we derived a recommendation whether to implement solar panels or connect to the existing grid. So that's it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Time for questions.
Thanks. I find this stuff on urban, these shapes fascinating because, there's possibly room to do work which looks at sort of the evolving trajectories of cities. Right. It isn't that people have planned for slums to be in particular places. The slums have come up on their own, and to a large extent, these reflect the failure of planning rather than anything that planning itself can do. They involve, political constituencies growing up around, folks have sort of illegally occupied land in a particular place, and then there's enough of them, and then you can't really shake them off. It's more to do with, like, bacteria with biofilms or something. They have a protection, and then you can't really touch them after that. So I'm curious about how much you incorporate those kinds of ideas into what you do and how much temporal data you have on how, different parts of cities evolve, things that follow urban planning protocols versus ones that do not.
Right. Yeah, so first of all, it's certainly a big advantage of this type of data to just observe, urban developments much closer to real time. And so the data we have at the moment is a little bit restricted, so it's more in the range of 1 to 2 years, so it's quite, the time horizons are not that long, but we are hoping to get more and more data, of course, which cover longer periods of time. And actually what you say is also quite interesting, because what we are observing right now is that that there are very strong commonalities between different cities in terms of their organizations, in terms of the number of places that attract a given number of people. So there are quite striking regularities independent of the top-down planning of those different cities. So for instance, Singapore is a city which is very much planned in a top-down manner, whereas more classic European cities like Lisbon has been growing more organically, and so we are comparing these two forms of urban organizations. And what we have observed so far is that they resemble to each other in a quite surprising way, which would also probably be extendable to more informal settings, as you mentioned.
So I have not heard a better group of postdoc talks in these meetings. So thank you very much to all of you.